Hello students, welcome to lesson number 5, The Happy Prince, written by Oscar Wilde. The Happy Prince was a beautiful statue. He was covered with gold, he had sapphires for eyes and a ruby in his sword. Why did he want to part with all the gold that he had and his precious stones? We will read the lesson and find out the reason for this. High above the city, on a tall column, stood the statue of the Happy Prince. He was gilded all over with thin leaves of fine gold. For eyes, he had two bright sapphires, and a large red ruby glowed on his sword hilt. One night there flew over the city a little swallow. His friends had gone away to Egypt 6 weeks before, but he had stayed behind. Then he decided to go to Egypt too. All day long he flew, and at night time he arrived at the city. "Where shall I put up?" he said. "I hope the town has made some preparations." Then he saw the statue on the tall column. So children, over here we can see that there was the statue of the Happy Prince on a tall column. It was like a pillar, and he was mounted up above that pillar, and he was gilded, means he was covered all over with thin leaves of fine gold. In the place of his eyes, there were two bright sapphires, that is precious stones, which are blue in color. And on his sword, the handle or the hilt of the sword, there was a large red ruby, which was red in color. And he was standing on that. And then one night, over the city, there flew a little swallow. Now the swallow is a little bird, which migrates to warmer countries during winter. The swallow's friends had already gone to Egypt, which is a warm country, 6 weeks before. That means almost 42 days before that. But he had stayed behind because he had fallen in love with a little reed. And he thought that the reed would leave its roots and come with him. But when the reed told him that it couldn't, then he decided to fly and go to Egypt. So all day long he flew, and at night time he arrived at that particular city. Then he wondered where he would stay. Where shall I put up means he wondered where he could stay. And then he hoped, he thought of, that he was quite important, and so he hoped that the town had made some preparations for him to stay. And then he saw the statue on a tall column, and he found the answer to his query. He thought that this is a good place to stay. It's a fine position with plenty of fresh air. So he alighted just between the feet of the Happy Prince. "I have a golden bedroom," he said softly to himself as he looked around. So as he was thinking where he would stay, he saw the Happy Prince. And since the Happy Prince was gilded with gold, he thought he would stay there for the night. And he felt very happy to have a nice golden bedroom all to himself. And then he looked around and he prepared to go to sleep. But just as he was putting his head under his wing, a large drop of water fell on him. "What a curious thing," he cried. "There is not a single cloud in the sky. The stars are quite clear and bright, and yet it is raining." Then another drop fell. "What is the use of a statue if it cannot keep the rain off?" he said. "I must look for good chimney pot." He was determined to fly away. But before he had opened his wings, a third drop fell. And he looked up and saw, what did he see? The eyes of the Happy Prince were filled with tears, and tears were running down his golden cheeks. His face was so beautiful in the moonlight that the little swallow was filled with pity. "Who are you?" he said. "I am the Happy Prince." "Why are you weeping then?" said the swallow. "You have quite drenched me." "When I was alive and had a human heart," answered the statue, "I did not know what tears were, for I lived in the palace where sorrow is not allowed to enter. My courtiers called me the Happy Prince, and happy indeed I was. So I lived and so I died, and now that I am dead, they have set me up here so high that I can see the ugliness and all the misery of my city, and though my heart is made of lead, yet I cannot choose but weep." So children, we will see. Now, so when the little swallow was just about to go to sleep, he felt a drop of water falling on him. And he thought, what a curious thing for this to happen. There wasn't a single cloud in the sky. The stars were quite clear and bright. And yet, how come it was raining? Then another drop fell, and he thought to himself, "What is the use of having such a big statue over me when it cannot keep the rain off?" He thought, "I must look for a good chimney pot, that means a place where I can be safe from this rain." And he thought he would fly away, but before he opened his wings, a third drop fell, and he looked up to see from where the water was coming. Ah, and what did he see? He saw the eyes of the happy prince welling up with tears, and the tears were running down his golden cheeks. His face was so beautiful in the moonlight that the little swallow was filled with pity. He asked him who he was, and the statue replied that he was the happy prince. Then he asked him the reason why he was weeping, and then the happy prince told him the reason. He said that when he was alive, he lived in a beautiful, wonderful palace, and at that time he said he was really happy. There was no reason for any sorrow, and since he didn't get out of the palace, he lived there happily and he died there happily. But after he died, the people made a big statue and put him up on a tall column. From there he could see all the ugliness, the misery, the sorrow in his city, and that was the reason why. He said even though his heart was made of lead, he could not help himself, but he had to weep looking at the sorrow of his people. And then the swallow thought to himself, "What? Is he not solid gold?" And then he thought this was too impolite to make any personal remarks, so he kept his thoughts to himself. Now let us continue reading. "Far away," continued the statue in a low musical voice, "far away in a little street there's a poor house. One of the windows is open, and through it I can see a woman seated at a table. Her face is thin and worn, and she has coarse red hands all pricked by the needle, for she is a seamstress. She is embroidering flowers on a satin gown for the loveliest of all the queen's maids of honor to wear at the next court ball. In a bed in the corner of the room, her little boy is lying ill. He has a fever and is asking his mother to give him oranges. His mother has nothing to give him but river water, so he is crying, 'Swallow, swallow, little swallow, will you not bring her the ruby out of my sword hilt? My feet are fastened to this pedestal and I cannot move.'" So children, so when the happy prince tells the swallow the reason for his tears, and then he says that far away in a little street there is a poor house. Now the house was not poor, the people living in it were poor, but this is like, you know, it's a transferred epithet, it's a figure of speech saying that poor house when the inhabitants of the house were poor. And one of the windows was open, and through that the happy prince said that he could see a woman seated at a table. She was very thin and very, like, you know, worn down by cares and sorrows. She had coarse, means very rough, red hands, all poked by the needle, because she was a seamstress. She was a lady who earned her living by stitching clothes, and so she was embroidering flowers on a satin gown for the queen's maids of honor. They were going to have a big party, which in the olden days, they used to call a party a ball, where they used to have a dance and they wore lovely clothes. So she said, the happy prince said that this lady was embroidering flowers so that the women, the queen's maids of honor, could wear it at the next court ball. Now, and in her house, in a bed in the corner of the room, her little son was lying ill. He had a fever and was asking his mother to give him oranges, but his mother had nothing to give him. They were so poor, and so he was crying. She had only river water to offer him. And so the happy prince requested the swallow in a very kind, polite tone, and said that could he, like, you know, pluck out that ruby from the hilt of his sword and take it to that seamstress so that she could sell that and get something for her child to eat. He said, "See, I am standing here, my feet are fastened on this pedestal, on this place that is above the pillar, and so I cannot move. So please help me." And so let us continue reading further. "I am waited for," the swallow answers the happy prince and says, "I am waited for in Egypt," said the swallow. "My friends are flying up and down the Nile, and talking to the large lotus flowers. Soon they will go to sleep. The prince asks the swallow to stay with him for one night and be his messenger. The boy is so thirsty and the mother is so sad, he said. I don't think I like boys, answered the swallow. I want to go to Egypt. So when the happy prince requests the swallow to do him a kind deed, then the swallow says that he needs to go to Egypt because all his friends are waiting for him there. And he said, my friends must be flying up and down the river Nile and talking to the large lotus flowers there. And soon they would all go to sleep. The prince asked the swallow to stay with him for one night and do and be his messenger and take that red ruby to that seamstress mother who could buy something for her little sick child. And the swallow said, I don't think I like boys. The reason was that many a times boys used to throw stones at the bird, and so he didn't like boys. And he said another reason was that he wanted to go to Egypt to be with his friends. But the happy prince looked so sad that the little swallow was sorry. It is very cold here, he said. But he agreed to stay with him for one night and be his messenger. Thank you, little swallow, said the prince. The swallow picked out the great ruby from the prince's sword and flew away with it in his beak over the roofs of the town. He passed by the cathedral tower where the white marble angels were sculptured. He passed by the palace and heard the sound of dancing. A beautiful girl came out on the balcony with her lover. I hope my dress will be ready in time for the state ball, she said. I have ordered flowers to be embroidered on it, but the seamstresses are so lazy. He passed over the river and saw the lanterns hanging on the masts of the ship. At last he came to the poor woman's house and looked in. The boy was tossing feverishly on his bed. The mother had fallen asleep. She was so tired. In he hopped and laid the great ruby on the table beside the woman's thimble. So children, when the happy prince had requested him several times, then he agreed. Like, you know, he felt sorry for the happy prince and he agreed to be the happy prince's messenger. So he plucked out the ruby from the happy prince's hilt of the sword and took it to give it to the seamstress. So off he went flying over, he flew over, passed by the cathedral tower where white marble angels were sculptured. Then he passed by the palace and heard the sound of dancing. And a beautiful girl came out with her lover and said she hoped to have her dress ready by the time the state ball took place. And she said she had ordered flowers to be embroidered. And she said that seamstresses were so lazy. That means she didn't really know the situation or the kind of life that the seamstresses were living in. And then he passed over the river and saw lanterns hanging on the masts of ships. Masts are the poles to which the sails are connected. At last he came to the poor woman's house and he saw that she had fallen asleep because she was tired and the sun was tossing feverishly about on the bed. So he went and laid it on the table beside the woman's thimble. Now the thimble is a small little cap worn on the thumb. It's a steel cap worn on the thumb so that the fingers don't get poked. Then he flew gently around the bed and fanned the boy's forehead with his wings. And how cool I feel, said the boy. I must be getting better. And he sank into a delicious slumber. So when the swallow got inside the room, he went and placed that jewel, the ruby, on the table and then went above the little boy and fanned him with his wings. And the boy thought, oh wow, I must be getting better. And so he sank into a very lovely sleep. Then the swallow flew back to the happy prince and told him what he had done. It is curious, he remarked, but I feel quite warm now, although it's so cold. Since it was winter was approaching, the weather was very cold. But after doing this good deed, the swallow reported a very strange thing to the happy prince. He said that, I don't know, even though the weather is cold, I feel so warm inside, and this good deed has given me great happiness. So this is because happy prince tells the swallow the reason for that. He says, that is because you have done a good action, said the prince. And then the little swallow began to think and then fell asleep. Thinking always made him sleepy. When day broke, he flew down to the river and had a bath. Tonight I go to Egypt, said the swallow. So after doing this good deed and returning back to the happy prince, he tells the happy prince that he was feeling warm. And the happy prince explained the reason for that. He said, it is because you have done this good deed. And so the little swallow began to think and fell asleep. And then when he woke up the next day, when the sun rose, he flew down to the river, had a bath and decided that that night he would go to Egypt. And he was in very high spirits at the prospect. That means the very thought of going to Egypt made him feel very happy. He visited all the monuments. That means he decided to have a tour of the city. He thought, let me go and have a look at everything. And he sat a long time on the top of the church steeple. That means it is like the topmost point of the church. When the moon rose, he flew back to the happy prince. Have you any commissions for Egypt? He cried. I am just starting. That means he asked the happy prince if he had any good deeds for him to do in Egypt. He says that since I am starting now, you can tell me and I will do whatever you want. Then the happy prince again requests him. Swallow, swallow, little swallow, said the prince. Will you stay with me one night longer? I am waited for in Egypt, answered the swallow. Swallow, swallow, little swallow, said the prince. Far away across the city, I see a young man in a garret. He is leaning over a desk covered with papers, and in the glass by his side there is a bunch of withered violets. His hair is brown and crisp, and his lips are as red as a pomegranate, and he has large and dreamy eyes. He is trying to finish a play for the director of the theater, but he is too cold to write any more. There is no fire in his grate, and hunger has made him faint. I will wait with you one night longer, said the swallow, who really had a good heart. He asked if he should take another ruby to the young playwright. So here, when the swallow went to the river, had a bath and came back and asked the happy prince, he told him that that night he would go to Egypt, and he asked him if he had any commissions for him in Egypt. But the happy prince requested him twice, saying that, could you stay with me one night longer? And in reply, the swallow told the happy prince that his friends were waiting for him in Egypt. And again, the happy prince requests him to stay there. He says that, see there, across the city, he says, I can see a young man in a garret. Now, it's like a room. It's like an attic. It's a room at the top of the house. So he says, this man is living there. And he is like, you know, he has a desk covered with papers. In a glass by his side, there's a bunch of withered violets. That means the violets have drooped. His hair is brown and crisp. His lips are as red as a pomegranate. He has large, dreamy eyes. And he's trying to complete a play for the director of the theater. But he's too cold to write anymore. There's no fire. That means in order to have a fire, he needs to buy wood. And he has no money. And he has no money for food either. And so here the happy prince tells the swallow to do him a good deed. So the swallow asks the happy prince, should he take another ruby and give it to him? To which the happy prince replies and says, no, there aren't any more rubies. He says, now you will have to, yes, so we will continue reading further. He says, my eyes are all that I have left. They are made of rare sapphires, which were brought out of India 1,000 years ago. He ordered the swallow to pluck out one of them and take it to the playwright. He will sell it to the jeweler and buy firewood and finish his play. So he told him that he had no more rubies, but what he had were his two eyes, which were made of sapphire, and they were so precious that they had been brought from India a thousand years ago. So he said, he told the swallow to pluck out his eye and take it and give it to the playwright, so that he would take it to the jeweler, sell it, buy firewood, and it would help him to finish his play. So the swallow said, dear prince, I cannot do that. He began to cry. Swallow, swallow, little swallow, said the prince, do as I command you. So the swallow plucked out the prince's eye and flew away to the young man's garret. It's the room at the top of the house. It was easy enough to get in, as there was a hole in the roof Through this he darted and came into the room. The young man had his head buried in his hands, so he did not hear the flutter of the bird's wings. And when he looked up, he found the beautiful sapphire lying on the withered violets. "I am beginning to be appreciated," he cried. "This is from some great admirer. Now I can finish my play." And he looked quite happy. So what the swallow did was that he didn't want to pluck out the eye of the happy prince, but because the happy prince insisted, he went and plucked out one sapphire, and he took it and flew to the garret where that young playwright lived. And that playwright was so tired that he had gone off to sleep. So he took that jewel and he placed it on the violets that were withered. And when he awoke, he saw and he exclaimed with joy that he was being appreciated and admired. And so then he, like, you know, he was hopeful. He said, "Oh, now I can sell this and I can complete my play." So then the next day, the swallow flew down to the harbor. He sat on the mast of a large vessel and watched the sailors working. "I am going to Egypt," cried the swallow, but nobody minded. And when the moon rose, he flew back to the happy prince. "I have come to bid you goodbye," he cried. "Swallow, swallow, little swallow," said the prince, "will you not stay with me one night longer?" "It is winter," cried the swallow, "and the snow will soon be here. In Egypt, the sun is warm on the green palm trees, and the crocodiles lie in the mud and look lazily about them." "In the square below," said the happy prince, "there stands a little match girl. She has let her matches fall in the gutter, and they are all spoiled. Her father will beat her if she does not bring home some money, and she is crying. She has no shoes." No, so we will continue with the explanation. So after the little swallow, like, you know, goes and gives the sapphire to the playwright and he comes back, then he, like, you know, next morning he goes to a ship and he watches the sailors working. And in his mind he's so happy, he says, "I am going to Egypt," but nobody paid him any attention. And when the moon rose, he went back to the happy prince and said that he had come to say goodbye to him. But the prince makes him another request and tells him that, "Will you not stay with me one night longer?" And to which the swallow replies that, "It is winter and the snow will soon come. But in Egypt, where my friends, all the other swallows are, the sun is warm on the green palm trees, the crocodiles lie in the mud and look lazily about them." But the happy prince says, "Down in the square below where I am standing, there is a little match girl, and she has allowed her matches to fall in the gutter, and they are all spoiled. And her father will beat her if she does not take home some amount of money. And that's the reason why she is very sad and she is crying. She has no shoes or stockings, and her little head is bare." So the happy prince instructs the swallow, "Pluck out my other eye and give it to her, and her father will not beat her." "I will stay with you one night longer," said the swallow, "but I cannot pluck out your eye. You will be quite blind then." "Swallow, swallow, little swallow," said the prince, "do as I command you." So he plucked out the prince's other eye and darted down with it. He swooped past the match girl and slipped a jewel into the palm of her hand. "What a lovely bit of glass," cried the little girl, and she ran home laughing. Then the swallow came back to the prince. "You are blind now," he said, "so I will stay with you always." "No, little swallow," said the poor prince, "you must go away to Egypt." "No, I will stay with you always," said the swallow, and he slept at the prince's feet. So the third time, when the happy prince requested the swallow, he did as he asked. He didn't want to pluck out the other eye, but on the happy prince kept on insisting, and so he plucked out the eye and swooped down and went to the little match girl and dropped it in the palm of her hand. She looked and she exclaimed with joy that, "Oh, what a pretty piece of glass," and she said that, "Now I will be able to take it home and my father will be very happy." And so after doing this good deed, the swallow returns back to the happy prince and tells him that, "Now, since you are blind, I am not going anywhere. I will stay with you always." But the happy prince, he says, no, 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 you must go to Egypt. But now the swallow knows what he has to do. So he says that he refused to go, and he said that I will never leave you. I am going to stay with you here always. And he slept at the prince's feet. All the next day he sat on the prince's shoulder and told him stories of what he had seen in strange lands. Dear little swallow, said the prince, you tell me of marvelous things, but more marvelous than anything is the suffering of men and women. There is no mystery so great as misery. Fly over my city, little swallow, and tell me what you see there. So, when, the next day began, the sun rose, the happy prince went and sat on the prince's shoulders and told him of the wonderful stories that he had seen in different places, in different countries. But the prince said, dear little swallow, you're telling me of wonderful things, of marvelous things, more marvelous than all this is the suffering of my men and women. What the happy prince meant, that you are telling me of people and of things whom I don't know about. For me, that has no meaning. What you need to tell me is about all the suffering, all the misery of the people in my kingdom, in my city. And so, there is no mystery so great as misery. And so he said, little swallow, you must see, you be my eyes, and you tell me what's happening in the city. So the little swallow flew over the great city and saw the rich making merry in their beautiful houses, while the beggars were sitting at the gates. He flew into dark lanes and saw the white faces of starving children looking out listlessly at the black streets. Under the archway of a bridge, two little boys were lying in each other's arms to try and keep themselves warm. How hungry we are, they said. You must not lie here, shouted the watchman, and they wandered out into the rain. Then he flew back and told the prince of what he had seen. I am covered with fine gold, said the prince. You must take it off, leaf by leaf, and give it to the poor. The living always think that gold can make them happy. So here, as we can see, children, after the swallow goes and does the good deed and gives the little match girl one of the sapphires that was left, the happy prince's eye, then he feels really happy. But he decides not to go to Egypt, since the happy prince was already blind. And so then he keeps telling him about all the things he had seen. And then when he says, he looks around the city and he sees where people are sad and suffering and very miserable, and he keeps on telling. He flies into dark lanes and sees the white faces of starving children, and he comes and he reports that to the happy prince. He says that they are very hungry and those children are lying there, and the watchman tries to scold them and they wander out into the rain. So the swallow goes and tells all that to the prince, and so the prince in response tells him that he was covered with gold, and he said that you must take it off leaf by leaf and give it to the poor. The living always think that living people think that gold can make them happy. So the swallow did as the happy prince asked. Leaf after leaf of the fine gold the swallow picked off, till the happy prince looked quite dull and grey. Leaf after leaf of the gold he took to the poor, and the children's faces grew rosier, and they laughed and played in the streets. We have bread now, they cried. And the snow came, and after the snow came the frost. The streets looked as if they were made of silver. Everybody went about in furs, and the little boys wore scarlet caps and skated on the ice. Scarlet is red in colour. So here, after the swallow goes and tells the happy prince about all the misery in the city, the happy prince instructs him to take all the leaves one by one and give it to the poor, till he is bare and there is not a single gold leaf left on him. And then he says, he goes and distributes all those gold leaves, and people and children, when they receive all the gold, they feel really happy. And then came the snow, and after that came the frost. It was like, you know, terribly cold. The streets look as if they were made of silver. Everybody went about in furs, and the little boys wore scarlet caps, means red caps, and skated on the ice. The poor little swallow grew colder and colder, but he would not leave the prince. He loved him too well. He picked up the crumbs outside the baker's door when the baker was not looking and tried to keep himself warm by flapping his wings. But at last he knew that he was going to die. He had just enough strength to fly up to the prince's shoulder once more. "Goodbye, dear prince," he murmured. "Will you let me kiss you enough? No. Kiss your hand. I am glad that you are going to Egypt at last, little swallow," said the prince. "You have stayed too long here, but you must kiss me on the lips, for I love you." "It is not to Egypt that I am going," said the swallow. "I am going to the house of death. Death is the brother of sleep, is he not?" And he kissed the happy prince on the lips and fell down dead at his feet. So here, then the swallow realized that the winter had already approached, and there was snow and there was frost, and he knew that he could not survive the cold any longer. So he went and he said goodbye to the happy prince, and the happy prince thought he was going to Egypt, and so he was happy for him. He said, "Oh, you're going to Egypt at last. Goodbye, dear prince." He says, will you let me kiss your hand?" He says that he was glad he was going, and he said, "You stayed here too long, but now you must kiss me on the lips because I love you." He says, no, it's not to Egypt. I'm not going to Egypt," he says. "I'm going to the house of death. Death is the brother of sleep, is he not?" And so he was ready to die. And he kissed the happy prince on the lips and fell down dead at his feet. At that moment, a curious crack sounded inside the statue, as if something had broken. The fact is, the leaden heart had snapped right into two. It certainly was a dreadfully hard frost. So when the swallow kissed the happy prince goodbye and fell down at his feet, a very strange thing happened. The heart of the happy prince, which was made of lead, it snapped into two. It broke into two with the sorrow. He missed the swallow a lot. And that early in the morning, the mayor was walking in the square below in company. That means in the company of the town councillors. And as they passed the column, they looked up at the statue. "Dear me, how shabby the happy prince looks," he said. "How shabby indeed," cried the town councillor, who always agreed with the mayor, and they went up to look at it. "The ruby has fallen out of his sword. His eyes are gone. He is golden no longer," said the mayor. "In fact, he is a little better than a beggar." "Little better than a beggar," said the town councillors. "And here is actually a dead bird at his feet," continued the mayor. "We really must issue a proclamation that birds are not allowed to die. Birds are not to be allowed to die here." And the town clerk made a note of the suggestion. So here, as we can see, the happy prince was very happy for the little swallow. And when he died, then his heart snapped into two. And the next morning, the mayor and the town councillors were taking a walk past that place, and they looked up and they saw the happy prince in a very shabby condition. There were no gold leaves, there was no red ruby, and there were no sapphires, so his eyes were bare. And so they said that this cannot be allowed to happen. And he says, "Look, there's a bird lying dead at his feet. We cannot allow birds to die here." And so he says they all came to the conclusion that the happy prince looked just like a beggar, and they said, "We must issue a proclamation that no birds will be allowed to die here." And the town clerk made a note of the suggestion. So they pulled down the statue of the happy prince, as he was no longer beautiful. "He was no longer useful," said the art professor at the university. Then they melted the statue into a furnace. "What a strange thing," said the overseer, the supervisor. Overseer is supervisor of the workmen at the foundry. Foundry is a place where they melt metal. "And so this broken lead heart will not melt in the furnace. We must throw it away." So they threw it on a dust heap where the dead swallow was also lying. Then, bring me the two most precious things in the city, said God to one of his angels. And the angel brought him the leaden heart and the dead bird. You have rightly chosen, said God, for in my garden of paradise this little bird shall sing forever, and in my city of gold the happy prince shall praise me. So here, as we can see, children, that when the mayor and the town councillors decided to take down the statue and have it melted in the furnace, they did that, they took it, but there was a strange thing that happened. The leaden heart would not melt. The rest of the statue melted. And so, since it would not melt, they took it and threw it on a dust heap where the swallow was lying dead. And so, in heaven, there's a wonderful scene. God spoke to his angels and said, ask them to bring two most precious things in the city. He instructed the angels, and the angels brought him the leaden heart and the dead bird. And God praised the angels and said they had rightly chosen, for in his garden of paradise that little bird should sing forever, and in his city of gold the happy prince will also praise him. That means God wanted these two most precious things brought heaven. So both the swallow and the happy prince were one of a kind. They felt the misery, they felt the sorrow and the suffering of the people, and they did all that they could to help the people around them. So what a wonderful message this lesson gives, that whatever we can do to make the sorrow and the suffering of people around us a little lighter, we must try and do that. So in whatever little way we can put a smile on the faces of the people around us, in our family, among our friends, relatives and neighbors, we must try and make their lives a little better. So children, now we will see the question answers of the lesson. Why do the courtiers call the prince the happy prince? Is he really happy? What does he see all around him? Well, the courtiers called him happy prince because he had no sorrows. He was really happy. And what did he see all around him? He saw nothing. While he was alive, he was inside the palace. And why does the happy prince send a ruby for the seamstress? Why does the swallow do? What does he do in the seamstress's house? So first of all, the happy prince sent the ruby so that he could help that poor little lady who was working so hard and yet unable to feed her child. So he wanted to, like, you know, help that seamstress in some little way. And so he took, he goes there and he places the ruby there on the table, and he fans the little boy so that he feels much better, and he drifts off into a delicious slumber. For whom did the prince send the sapphires and why? The first sapphire the prince sent for a playwright who was unable to complete a play for the director of theatre because there was no wood in the grate. And because of the extreme cold, he was unable to write. Also, he was very, very hungry. The second sapphire he sent for the little match girl whose matches had fallen into the gutter. And so she could not have sold anything that day. And she knew she would get a beating from her father. So in order to save the little match girl from a beating of her father, the happy prince gave away his second sapphire that were in place of his eyes. What does the swallow see when it flies over the city? When the swallow flies over the city, he sees the misery, the sorrow, the suffering, the poor people who are so poor that they'd have no proper clothes to wear, that they are lying out in the cold trying to, like, you know, cuddle up closer to each other. And so he goes and tells the happy prince all about the suffering and sad people in his city. Why did the swallow not leave the prince and go away to Egypt? Although the swallow wanted very much to go to Egypt and join his friends there, he knew it was his duty and responsibility to stay with his friend, the happy prince, who did so much in order to relieve the suffering and the misery in his city. So he felt it was only fitting that he too not leave the happy prince, as now he had become blind, and so that he did not want to go to Egypt. What are the precious things mentioned in the story? Why are they precious? The precious things mentioned in the story are the happy prince's heart and the swallow. Why were they said to be precious? The happy prince was happy while he was alive, but now that he was dead, he understood the real suffering, sorrow and misery of the people, and he did whatever he could. He had given off his gold, he had given his ruby, he had given all the precious jewels away in order to relieve the people of their sufferings. And even though the swallow wanted to go to Egypt, yet he did not do what he wanted, but he did as the swallow asked him. That means he was a true friend to the happy prince. And so God considers both the happy prince and the little bird, the little swallow, to be really precious, because they did all that they could to make the suffering of the people around them much easier. Now, the little swallow says, "It is curious, but I feel quite warm now, although it is so cold. Have you ever had such a feeling? Share your experience with your friends." Instead of sharing, you can just write a paragraph about it. And then suggested readings, The Selfish Giant by Oscar Wilde, that is in the supplementary reader of the 8th standard. So you could read it if you have any friend in the 8th standard. And how much land does a man require? This is written by Leo Tolstoy and it makes for very good reading. So children, read this lesson a few times and look at the questions and make sure you write the question answers in your fair book. Thank you and have a nice day.